There's another bathroom here. So we do things like the hallway lighting comes on and off with motion sensors so that no one leaves the lights on, basically. There's a bathroom in there. We've got four bedrooms. Okay. So again, you know, there's been quite a lot of money spent on tiles, getting it looking nice, keeping it clean, and then people don't mind paying their rent. I'm just going to go this way. Stuart? So this room, so this is one of the bedrooms. This is the room that the guy has left. So basically we provide bedding, wardrobes, chest of drawers. The guys keep their own rooms clean. I don't provide bedding. Someone's left a mattress. Landlords, you know this problem, people leave stuff. And as a landlord, I can't just get rid of that. I have to pay for that as commercial waste. So, for me. But there's stuff that makes it more expensive, so people just assume it's easy being a landlord. The reality is, it's a commercial business, that's now commercial waste. If I want to get rid of that, it won't just get taken away by the council, so there's a cost. So anyone that's done the math when I said there's eight people living here, or who wants to do the math and it's £390 per room per month, and go, oh my god, you must be caning it, that's like over £3,000. Yeah, it is, and the costs are huge. There's a cleaner, there's Sky TV, there's whatever the Virgin mega broadband is. All of the bills, the management, the voids, all of that kind of thing. So for those thinking it's you just need one of these and you're made, it's not true. But they do cash flow nicely. I'm not gonna lie, it's a brilliant house. There's one boiler, and it probably makes the same as three or four small houses, but I only have to repair one boiler, one roof. One kitchen, well, one and a half kitchens in this house. Cool, let's go. So this is a really good example. That light isn't working. It needs sorting. So it's just coming in and checking things that, you know, that have failed and making sure they work, because this is the fire exit. And although there's a separate fire system, I don't want anyone falling down the stairs. So again, we've got four bedrooms on this floor and another bathroom here. So I like to have two people per bathroom in an HMO. Any more than that, and people are like, well, no, I want my own bathroom. Probably are people up here, so I'll just check. And watch this step, it's a bit higher. We had to level this whole floor. This was the attic, so these stairs are original, but this wasn't done. So all of this is brand new up here to kind of give the house more space. So I'll just show you in. This is the laundry room, and if you go around there, this is the boiler system that it takes to run a house this size. So you've got a tank just for cold water, you've got a hot water tank, and then a combi boiler. And there's a secondary flow and return system here, so that there's always hot water at the tap. So if you imagine a normal house, it goes from the combi boiler to the tap, and there's a lag where it's cold water. Well, we've just come up three flights of stairs. That's a long way for the water to go. So the water actually goes in a loop, hot loop around, and then the sinks come off that, so there's always hot water, unless the boiler fails, which again can be we've had a lot of issues lately with boiler failing and just the usage of it. Another bathroom.
So what's involved with owning an HMO in terms of regulations, unexpected costs that people might not realise?
So this is a really big HMO, so they're all different, but this has emergency lighting that you can see there. This is the only exit, so we have a double lobbied doors. So when you go into a bedroom, that's a door, and then there's another door into the bedroom, because this fire escape is the only fire escape for people to get out, so it needs to be really protected. I have to make sure the tenants don't leave stuff at the bottom of the stairs, because it's a trip hazard. So if there is a fire and everyone's got to get out, this is the main way out. There is an integrated fire system, so there are these on every level. There are sirens. Every room has a smoke detector. That needs checking every 6 months, so I pay a company to come in and check it every 6 months. The cleaners set it off every week to make sure it's working. So again, people don't estimate the cost of that, you know, paying cleaners 2 or 3 hours a week to do all of that kind of thing. What else? So we have a fire panel and an integrated fire system, so it's a lot bigger than most, because of the size of the HMO. So each HMO is different, but Fire doors is another one. You know, these are actual fire doors. They're not normal doors, so they're more expensive. So the refurb is more expensive. So just adding a fire alarm system for this house is $2,000 or $3,000, which that's quite cheap. If there are people watching this in, you know, Southeast England, they'll go, oh my God, that's so cheap. But we're in Wales and, you know, it's all relative. This house was only $175,000 to buy. You know, most people watching it. And this is, I've only shown you the four stories of the house. There's another one bed garden flat downstairs where I used to live. It's now valued at $325,000 just for the house, and the flat downstairs is valued at $85,000. So it's made and another $50,000 basically with the last valuation. But the refurb for this was $100,000, and that was, it was expensive, but I was really tight on everything. So, it, you know, everything was really keen. I was going around tile shops, getting the best deals, dealing with like end of line stuff. So it could have, if you did something like this and didn't manage it properly, it could have been $150,000 easy. Still would have made money, but it would have run into $150,000. So it's a lot of money in, but then it works.
Does the HMO, does the licensing people come around and inspect everything you've done before it gets...
Funnily enough, that reminds me, they've emailed me last week. I need to give them a date. I could have done it today. They come around every year and check it. And they also advise me. Ron, the kind of TAF council, are amazing. They came and advised me before I even bought about what I'd need to do so I could get a good idea. But a lot of councils are very reactive. So they will not come out unless there's been a complaint. So you have to just go through all of their documents online, which can be... it can be a bit tricky to kind of navigate those. Whereas when you have a human being who knows, who walks around the property and goes, yes, you need this, 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 and this, it's much easier. But they come every year and check. If someone complains to the council, they come and check. And you know, the guys are great. Environmental health are actually really helpful as a department in the council, but a lot of people don't see them as that. So.
There's the license for HMOs, isn't there?
Yeah, so you need planning permission and you need a license. So one of my groups now, actually, they're buying a deal that's already done, and the guy thought it had planning permission and it doesn't. So I said to them, do not buy until you've got, you know, confirmation of that, because it's expensive. It's several hundred pounds for the planning application, but you actually also need an architect or a drawing, you know, designer to draw the floor plan. You need to design an access statement, which is a couple of hundred pounds. So there's quite a lot of costs up front for making sure it happens. This area is quite easy to get an HMO license, but if you go a couple of streets down into the student land, it's really difficult to get an HMO license now. So you have to be careful that stuff like that doesn't bite you on the arse, basically. And you think, oh yeah, this house would be a great HMO. You do that in Newport, and then the council will go, yeah, but you need parking space for every room. And that wipes out most deals in Newport that would be good for an HMO, unless they've already got a license. And a lot of houses now have a license, but they don't have planning, because the planning is a new thing. So you then have to apply for planning, even though you've already got an HMO license. So it's basically, there's a tick list of things you've got to check that it has. So it is more involved, it is a bit more regulated, there is more stuff to do. But you get paid for that too. You know, this house, it makes good money. It has its challenges, but it's worth it.